Welcome to my video tutorial on gross anatomy of uterus. We will be looking into the following objectives in this topic: general features and presenting parts of uterus, axis of uterus, which explains its position, relations of the parts, structure and supports of uterus, blood supply, nerve supply, lymphatic drainage, and few applied aspects. So let's begin. Uterus. It's a female reproductive organ located within the lesser pelvis below the pelvic brim. It's a midline structure, lies behind the urinary bladder and in front of rectum. Uterus is situated obliquely within the pelvic cavity, which can be observed in a sagittal section of female pelvis. Anteriorly related with urinary bladder and posteriorly related with rectum. It's a thick-walled hollow muscular organ. It opens below into vagina. It's a pear-shaped structure or inverted pear-shaped structure with the following measurements: 7.5 centimeters in length, 5 cm in breadth and 2.5 cm in thickness. On an average, it weighs about 30 to 40 grams. Presenting parts of uterus. It shows three parts from above downwards. They are fundus, body and cervix. Cervix opens into vagina below. Let's see the location and presenting parts of uterus in the following video clip. Here are the superior pubic rami, here is the pelvic brim, and here is the sacral promontory. Here is the uterus within the pelvic cavity with fallopian tubes and ovaries onto the lateral pelvic walls. Here is the rectum behind. Here is the urinary bladder in front of the uterus. Parts of the uterus are above convex portion, fundus, which continues as body and cervix below. Uterus encloses uterine cavity, which is seen as a triangular shaped cavity in coronal section, longitudinal slit in sagittal section, and horizontal slit in cross section. Let's see the further details of presenting parts of uterus. Fundus. It lies above the level of uterine tubes or fallopian tubes. It does not enclose uterine cavity and above it is completely covered by peritoneum. Coming to the body. Here is the posterior superior view of pelvic cavity with pelvic viscera. Here is the urinary bladder behind the pubic symphysis. Here is the rectum with sigmoid colon in front of the sacrum. Here is the body of uterus, which shows following features. Two surfaces, anterior surface and posterior surface. Anterior surface is related with urinary bladder. Two lateral borders. Here they are. Two lateral angles or cornuae, which are seen at the junction of fundus and body. The two lateral borders of uterus give attachment to double-layered peritoneal fold known as broad ligament of uterus, which connects the uterus with the lateral pelvic walls. At each cornu of uterus, three structures are related. They are above fallopian tube, in front round ligament of uterus, behind ligament of ovary. So each cornu of uterus give attachment or receives openings of fallopian tube above, round ligament of uterus in front, and ligament of ovary behind. Let's revise. Body has two surfaces, anterior surface, posterior surface, two lateral borders to which broad ligament is attached. The lateral borders are non-peritoneal. Along the lateral borders, uterine vessels run. Two cornuae or lateral angles They are seen at the junction of fundus and body. At each cornu, three structures are attached to uterus. Fallopian tube, round ligament of uterus and ligament of ovary. Cervix. It begins at a narrow constriction of the uterus known as isthmus, which is nothing but junction of body and cervix. Cervix itself is a narrow cylindrical part of the uterus, 2.5 cm in length. At birth, it is 2 times larger than the body, whereas in fully developed uterus, it forms only 1/3 of the body. Depending on the attachment of vaginal wall, cervix can be divided into 2 parts. Upper supravaginal part and lower vaginal part or intravaginal part, which means vaginal part of cervix lies within the vaginal canal. The portion of vaginal canal surrounding the vaginal part of cervix known as vaginal fornix, which can be divided into 4 parts: anterior fornix, posterior fornix and 2 lateral fornices. The vaginal fornices are 4 in number. They are nothing but portions of vaginal canal surrounding the vaginal part of cervix: anterior, posterior and 2 lateral fornices. The cavity of cervix, known as cervical canal, it communicates above with the cavity of body and below with the vaginal canal through 2 narrow openings or ostia, called as internal os above and external os below. Internal os corresponds with the level of isthmus. The mucosa of cervical canal is lined by simple columnar epithelium, which shows number of mucosecreting glands. The mucosal layer is thrown into folds in the form of a tree. Such pattern of mucosal elevations known as arbor vitae uteri, which is seen in nulliparous uterus. During pregnancy, upper 1/3 of the cervical canal is taken up by the rest of the uterine cavity to form lower uterine segment. So the upper 1/3 of the cervical canal, called as functional isthmus. The outer surface of vaginal portion of cervix lined by stratified epithelium, which is the lining epithelium of vaginal canal, which means around the external os, the epithelial lining differs. Here is the intravaginal portion of cervix seen through the vaginal canal. Here is the external os, where mucosal lining shows abrupt change from simple columnar epithelium to stratified squamous epithelium, which means it's a mucocutaneous junction, which is a frequent site of cervical cancer. It acts like a transitional zone. Here is the sagittal section of uterus with intravaginal portion of cervix, which shows 2 lips, anterior lip and posterior lip. Posterior lip is lengthier, as the posterior wall of vagina attaches to cervix at a higher level than its anterior wall. But it is the anterior lip which is felt during pervaginal examination than the posterior lip. Coming to axis of uterus, parts of uterus do not lie in the same plane as their axis differ in their direction. Axis of body makes an angle with axis of cervix known as angle of antiflexion, which is 125 degrees. Axis of cervix makes an angle with axis of vagina known as angle of antiversion, which is 90 degrees. So the uterus shows anteflexion between its body and cervix. Anteversion between its cervix and vagina. Now let's see the relations of uterus, which can be studied by its peritoneal relations and visceral relations. Let's see the peritoneal relations of uterus. The visceral peritoneum covering the uterus forms two layers, anterior layer and posterior layer. Both the layers are continuous with each other over the fundus, which means fundus is completely covered by the peritoneum. The anterior layer of visceral peritoneum covers the anterior surface of the body and reflects onto the superior surface of urinary bladder, which means it do not cover the anterior surface of supravaginal portion of the cervix. Coming to the posterior layer, it covers the posterior surface of body and also covers the posterior surface of supravaginal portion of cervix. Then it reflects onto the rectum. Bilaterally, the two layers extend towards the lateral pelvic wall in the form of broad ligament of uterus, which is nothing but double layered peritoneal fold, which connects the uterus to the lateral pelvic wall, which means the lateral borders of the body are not covered by visceral layer of peritoneum. They remain as non-peritoneal along with anterior surface of supravaginal portion of cervix. These two portions of the uterus are non-peritoneal. Anteriorly, the visceral layer of peritoneum, while reflecting onto the superior surface of urinary bladder, it shows a deep indentation. Similarly, posterior layer also shows a deep indentation between rectum and supravaginal portion of the cervix. Such deep indentations of peritoneal layers known as peritoneal pouches. The peritoneal pouch between uterus and the urinary bladder known as uterovesical pouch. Here it is. The peritoneal pouch between the uterus and the rectum known as rectouterine pouch, which is also known as pouch of Douglas. Let's understand these pouches by looking at the following video clip. Here is the uterus lifted up, showing the pouch of Douglas or rectouterine pouch between the uterus and the rectum. Here is the peritoneal pouch between the urinary bladder and the uterus, vesicouterine or uterovesical pouch. Few details about rectouterine pouch or pouch of Douglas. Here it is. It is the most dependent part of female peritoneal cavity in erect position as well as in supine position. It lies 5.5 cm above the anus and 7.5 cm above the vaginal orifice. Boundaries of the pouch. Anteriorly, it is related with posterior surface of vagina, including posterior fornix. Posteriorly related with middle third of the rectum. Floor is formed by peritoneal reflection between vagina and rectum called as rectovaginal fold. Bilaterally, the lateral walls are formed by peritoneal reflections from uterus to rectum known as rectouterine folds. Here they are. So the point to be understood in peritoneal relations of uterus is the visceral layer of peritoneum, after covering the uterus, it reflects onto the adjacent viscera and forms peritoneal pouches. Anteriorly, it forms uterovesical pouch. Posteriorly, it forms rectouterine pouch or pouch of Douglas, which is deepest pouch compared to uterovesical pouch and most dependent part of female peritoneal cavity. Let's see the visceral relations of uterus. Anteriorly, it is related with superior surface of urinary bladder, on which body of the uterus rests. Posteriorly, it is related with anterior surface of rectum, sigmoid colon, and few coils of small intestine. Lateral relations are ureter, which lies 2 cm away from the cervix. The two non-peritoneal lateral borders of the uterus are intimately related with uterine artery and uterine vein, which run between the two layers of visceral peritoneum, which forms bilaterally broad ligament. So the lateral relations are ureter, uterine vessels, and broad ligament of uterus. Moving on to structure of the uterus. The wall of uterus is composed of three layers. From within outwards, they are endometrium, myometrium, and perimetrium. Endometrium is the innermost layer, also called as mucosal layer. Myometrium is made up of smooth muscles, and perimetrium is called as serous layer. Let's see the further details of three layers of uterine wall. Endometrium, it is nothing but inner mucosal layer of uterine wall. It is lined by simple columnar epithelium. Endometrium undergoes changes during different phases of uterine cycle or menstrual cycle. Histologically, it shows three zones from luminal surface to myometrium. They are stratum compactum, stratum spongiosum, and stratum basale. The inner two layers, stratum compactum and spongiosum, together called as functional layer of endometrium, as these are the two layers which are going to be shed off during menstrual phase of uterine cycle. In further phases, stratum basale or basal layer going to proliferate and restore the thickness of endometrium. Myometrium, it makes up the bulk of uterine wall. It is formed by smooth muscle fibers, which are arranged as outer longitudinal fibers, middle circular fibers, and inner reticular fibers, which are irregularly arranged. Coming to perimetrium, it is nothing but the visceral layer of peritoneum covering different parts and surfaces of uterus. Now it's time to see the supports of uterus, which are classified into ligaments of uterus, fibromuscular supports, and mechanical supports of uterus. They maintain the position of uterus in the pelvic cavity. Let's see the features of supports of uterus in detail. Ligaments of uterus. Structurally and functionally, they can be classified into true ligaments and false ligaments. True ligaments are composed of fibrous tissue. They act as primary supports to uterus. False ligaments are formed by peritoneal folds, so they act as secondary supports to uterus. True ligaments are four-paired, whereas false ligaments are two paired ligaments and two unpaired ligaments. Let's see the attachments of these ligaments. True ligaments of uterus. Here the image is showing cross-section of pelvic cavity at the level of cervix of uterus with urinary bladder in front and rectum behind. There are three pairs of true ligaments which radiate from cervix towards lateral pelvic wall. They are anteriorly pubocervical ligaments, bilaterally transverse cervical ligaments or ligaments of McEnroth or cardinal ligaments, posteriorly uterosacral ligaments. The pubocervical ligaments extend from posterior surface of corresponding body of pubis. From there, they wind round the uterus at posterior surface of supravaginal portion of cervix, where they continue with each other. Transverse cervical ligaments, they extend from lateral surface of supravaginal portion of cervix towards lateral pelvic walls. Uterosacral ligaments, which extend between posterior surface of supravaginal portion of cervix and vagina. 2. Ventral surface of third sacral vertebra. So these are the three main true ligaments which support the position of cervix in the pelvic cavity. The fourth pair of true ligaments is nothing but round ligaments of uterus. They are attached at the corner of body of uterus along with fallopian tube and ligament of ovary. Each round ligament of uterus runs forwards within the pelvic cavity till it reaches the deep inguinal ring. From there, it enters into inguinal canal and becomes the content of the canal. It leaves the canal through the superficial inguinal ring, reaches the anterior surface of body of pubis, where it blends with the connective tissue of labia majora. So the round ligament of uterus, it runs forwards within the inguinal canal and ends in the external genitalia. So the true ligaments which are radiating from the cervix, pubocervical, transverse cervical and uterosacral ligaments, they support the cervix by maintaining the anteversion of uterus, which means they maintain the angle between cervix and vagina. Round ligaments of uterus, as they are directed forwards, they maintain the anteflexion of uterus, which means they maintain the angle between body and cervix of the uterus. So basically, true ligaments of uterus maintain anteversion and anteflexion of the uterus. Such function is also seen in gravid uterus. True ligaments maintain the position of uterus within the pelvic cavity and in abdominal cavity during pregnancy. So the true ligaments act as primary supports of uterus, which are four pairs. From anterior to posterior, they are pubocervical ligaments, round ligaments of uterus, transverse cervical ligaments or cardinal ligaments or McEnroe's ligaments, posteriorly uterosacral ligaments. Coming to false ligaments of uterus, they are two paired and two unpaired ligaments. They are formed by peritoneal folds. Let's see the paired false ligaments. They are broad ligaments of uterus, which connect the lateral borders of uterus to lateral pelvic walls, and rectouterine folds, which are nothing but peritoneal folds covering the underlying uterosacral ligaments. They also form the lateral walls of rectouterine pouch of Douglas. Coming to unpaired false ligaments, they are seen in the midline. They are formed by reflections of visceral layer of peritoneum from uterus to urinary bladder in front and rectum behind. They are called as uterovesical fold and rectovaginal fold. Uterovesical fold forms the floor of uterovesical pouch, whereas rectovaginal fold forms the floor of rectouterine pouch of Douglas. Few details about broad ligaments of uterus. They are nothing but double-layered peritoneal folds. They show following parts: two surfaces, anterior and posterior, four borders, upper, lower, medial and lateral borders. Posterior surface is related with corresponding ovary and its ligaments. Along the upper border, the two layers are continuous with each other over the fallopian tube. Along its lower border, the two layers diverge over transverse cervical ligament or ligament of McEnroe. Along its lateral border, the two peritoneal layers diverge over the lateral pelvic wall anteriorly and posteriorly. Along its medial border, the two peritoneal layers attach to the lateral border of body of uterus and continuous with the visceral layer of peritoneum of the uterus. Along its medial border, the two layers enclose uterine vessels which run along the lateral border of the body of uterus. Here the image is showing lateral view of broad ligament. It is formed by double layered peritoneum. So it has anterior layer and posterior layer. The posterior layer encloses uterine tube or fallopian tube and ovary so that both the structures are suspended by posterior layer of broad ligament. Depending on that, the broad ligament can be divided into three parts. They are mesosalpinx, the portion of posterior layer of broad ligament which is suspending the fallopian tube. Mesovarium, the portion of broad ligament suspending the ovary. Mesometrium, the rest of the broad ligament which has anterior and posterior layers, known as mesometrium. So there are three divisions of broad ligament depending on the suspension of fallopian tube and ovary by posterior layer. Contents of broad ligaments. Each broad ligament encloses few structures between its two peritoneal layers. Along its upper border, the two layers encloses structures attached to cornu of uterus. They are uterine tube or fallopian tube, round ligament of uterus and ligament of ovary. Within its posterior layer, broad ligament encloses ovary and suspensory ligament of ovary or infundibulopelvic ligament which connects the ovary to lateral pelvic wall. Along the medial border of broad ligament, the two layers enclose ovarian and uterine vessels which run along the non-peritoneal lateral border of the uterus. The portion of broad ligament between the ovary and fallopian tube shows narrow tubules and ducts. The tubules are 12 to 15 in number, vertically oriented, seen above the ovary. They unite to form larger ducts. They are remnants of proximal mesonephric tubules and ducts. They are called as hypoophoron. Similarly, between the ovary and uterus, few tubules and ducts are seen. They are called as paraophoron. So, hypoophoron and paraophoron are the remnants of proximal and distal portions of mesonephric tubules and ducts respectively. So these are the contents of broad ligament which are seen between the two peritoneal layers of broad ligament. That is about the ligaments of uterus, which play a major role in supporting the uterus within the pelvic cavity. They are structurally and functionally classified into true and false ligaments. True ligaments act as primary supports. They are four pairs of ligaments: round ligament of uterus, pubocervical ligaments, transverse cervical and uterosacral ligaments. False ligaments are peritoneal folds. They act as secondary supports. They are two paired ligaments and two unpaired ligaments. Paired ligaments are broad ligaments and rectouterine folds. Unpaired ligaments are uterovesical fold and rectovaginal fold. Moving on to fibromuscular supports of uterus. They support the uterus from below. They are pelvic diaphragm or levator ani muscles, urogenital diaphragm which is seen within the deep perineal pouch. Perineal body, it's a fibromuscular body, can be seen through the sagittal section of pelvic region. Here is the perineal body, seen at the junction of urogenital triangle in front and anal triangle behind. It is formed by attachments of different perineal muscles. It forms a major fibromuscular support for pelvic viscera. The pelvic diaphragm muscle fibers which support the uterus are pubovaginalis, which extends from posterior surface of body of pubis to vaginal wall. Puborectalis, which extends from posterior surface of body of pubis to posterior surface of anorectal junction, where it continues with the opposite puborectalis muscle to form a continuous muscular sling known as puborectal sling, so that the anorectal junction shows forward bend or anorectal flexure, on which posterior wall of the vagina rests posteriorly, so that anteversion of the uterus is maintained. Coming to urogenital diaphragm, it is pierced by vagina. The muscle fibers of urogenital diaphragm act as sphincter, maintain the position of the vagina, prevents the descent of uterus. So these are the major fibromuscular supports for uterus. Let's see the mechanical supports of uterus. They are nothing but position of uterus within the pelvic cavity, that is anteversion and anteflexion of the uterus, and relation of adjacent viscera, upper surface of urinary bladder on which body of the uterus rests, anorectal flexure on which vagina rests, so that anteversion and antiflexion are maintained. Apart from these, intra-abdominal pressure also helps in maintaining the position of uterus. So that is about the supports of uterus, which are ligaments, fibromuscular supports and mechanical supports. They maintain the position of uterus within the pelvic cavity. They should be understood in detail with their functional correlation. Let's move on to arterial supply of the uterus. Uterus is supplied by three major sources. They are uterine artery, vaginal artery and ovarian artery. Uterine and vaginal arteries are branches of internal iliac artery, whereas ovarian artery is one of the lateral branches of abdominal aorta. So these are the three major arterial sources for uterus. Let's see the further details of arterial supply of uterus. Uterine artery, it's a branch of anterior division of internal iliac artery. On its course, it gives occasionally vaginal artery, which may arise from anterior division of internal iliac artery. It supplies the vagina and continue as inferior vesical artery. Uterine artery, on its course through the pelvic cavity, it runs superficial to corresponding ureter, which lies 2 cm lateral to cervix. Once the uterine artery reaches the cervix, it gives off vaginal branches and starts ascending along the lateral border of body of the uterus with tortuosity till it reaches the cornu of uterus. At the cornu of uterus, uterine artery runs along the fallopian tube and supplies it. It also gives off ovarian branches and anastomose with the branches of ovarian artery. The point to be noted here is, once the uterine artery reaches the lateral surface of cervix, it enters between the two layers of broad ligament and becomes content of the broad ligament. It shows a greater tortuosity along the non-peritoneal lateral border of the uterus. Here is the superior view of pelvic cavity at the level of cervix of uterus. Here is the urinary bladder in front, rectum behind. Here is the common iliac artery dividing into external iliac and internal iliac arteries. Here is the uterine artery, which is a branch of anterior division of internal iliac artery. Uterine artery, along its course through the pelvic cavity, intimately related with two major structures before it reaches the cervix. They are transverse cervical ligament or ligament of Meckenrods, on which the artery runs, and ureter. Artery passes superficial to the ureter, which lies 2 cm lateral to the cervix. So during hysterectomy, removal of uterus, the artery should be ligated close to the cervix, keeping in view of its relation with ureter. Along the lateral border of the uterus, uterine artery gives off number of uterine branches. which pierce the perimetrium and enters into myometrium of the uterine wall, where they give off arcuate arteries. Each arcuate artery divides into anterior and posterior divisions, which supply the corresponding walls of the uterus. Each arcuate artery gives off radial arteries, which run through the myometrium and reaches the endometrium, where they give off branches to endometrium called as stratum vasculare, which supply the different strata of endometrium. The branches supplying the stratum basal called as basal branches. The branches supplying the stratum spongiosum and stratum compactum, they show a spiral course, so they are known as spiral branches. So radial arteries give off two sets of branches, basal branches and spiral branches. They are together called as stratum vasculare, as they supply different strata of endometrium. Spiral branches are going to be cut and shed off during the menstrual phase of uterine cycle. Bleeding from the radial arteries during menstrual phase is stopped by contraction of inner reticular fibers of myometrium. As the reticular fibers are arranged irregularly, the gaps between the reticular fibers is occupied by the vessels. Contraction of these fibers causes constriction of radial arteries and stop the bleeding from radial arteries during menstrual phase of uterine cycle. So the inner layer of myometrium is called as living ligature of the uterus. Moving on to venous drainage of the uterus. Veins draining the uterus follow the arteries and finally they drain into internal iliac veins. Nerve supply of uterus. Uterus is innervated by autonomic nerve fibers. Sympathetic nerves are derived from T12 to L1 spinal cord segments. They reach the uterus through inferior hypogastric plexus. They act as vasoconstrictors to uterus. Parasympathetic nerve fibers come from S2 to S4 spinal cord segments. They reach the uterus through vagus nerves and act as vasodilators. Pain from the uterus received by sympathetic as well as parasympathetic systems. Pain from body of the uterus received by T12 spinal cord segment, whereas pain from cervix received by S2 to S3 spinal cord segments. Let's see the lymphatic drainage of uterus. Lymph channels from fundus and upper part of the body drain into pre and para aortic group of lymph nodes. Lymphatics from the lower part of the body drain into external iliac group of lymph nodes. Lymphatics from the cervix drain into a wide range of lymph nodes. They are paracervical lymph nodes, external iliac, internal iliac and sacral group of lymph nodes. Lymph channels from the lateral angles of the uterus or cornuae do not drain into abdominal lymph nodes. They drain into superficial inguinal group of lymph nodes below the inguinal ligament. So the uterus shows wide range of lymphatic drainage. The point to be noted here is lymphatics from the cervix drained by four sets of lymph nodes and cornuae drained by superficial inguinal lymph nodes, which are seen on the front of the thigh. Now it's time to see the applied aspects. Hysteroscopy. Visualizing the interior of uterus through hysteroscope called as hysteroscopy. Hysterosalpingography. It's a radiological procedure in which a contrast material is injected through the vagina into the uterine cavity and an X-ray is taken. Here is the contrast material flowing through the uterine cavity, passing through the fallopian tubes and spilling into the pelvic cavity. It is advised to observe the congenital anomalies of uterus or blockages in the fallopian tubes. Colpotomy, cutting through the vaginal wall It is done to approach the rectouterine pouch of Douglas in case of accumulation within the pouch, as it is the most dependent part of female pelvic cavity. The accumulation can be drained from its floor by approaching through the posterior vaginal fornix, which lies 7.5 cm above the vaginal orifice. Retroversion of uterus, in which uterus do not lie in its antiversion position. It shows backward tilt towards the rectum. Such retroverted position of uterus may lead to prolapse of uterus, which is defined as protrusion of the uterus or parts of the uterus through the vaginal canal into vaginal orifice. For prolapse of uterus, retroversion of uterus is a prerequisite. Prolapse of uterus may be associated with prolapse of urinary bladder. Base of the urinary bladder may protrude backwards through the vaginal canal into vaginal orifice. At the vaginal orifice, it is covered by anterior vaginal wall. Such prolapse is known as cystocele. Prolapse of uterus may be associated with prolapse of rectum. The anterior wall of the rectum may protrude through the vaginal canal into the vaginal orifice, where it is covered by posterior wall of the vagina. Such prolapse is known as rectocele. Endometriosis. It's a benign condition where abnormal proliferation of endometrial tissue is seen outside the endometrium or uterine cavity. It may be found on the ovaries or fallopian tubes or pouch of Douglas or in the lungs. Leiomyomas or fibroids. They are the commonest benign tumors affecting the uterine muscles. They grow rapidly during pregnancy and regress after the menopause. Depending on their location, they can be classified as intramural fibroids, submucosal fibroids, subserosal fibroids, and pedunculated fibroids. Cervical cancer. It is the commonest cause of cancer deaths seen in females of underdeveloped countries. 80% of cervical cancers belong to squamous cell carcinomas. They can be treated depending on the spread or stage of cervical cancer by hysterectomy or radiation therapy or chemotherapy. Here is the end of this video with detailed anatomy of uterus. Thank you for your patient listening. Keep learning.